I must pretend to agree with the plan, but as soon as Micanopy and I are free of these Americans, I must convince him that this is not a good plan and that we should prepare for war. I will smile and pretend that I am for the plan, but I cannot agree to this. What they are proposing leaves my people only two options: return to enslavement or prevail on the battlefield. The Americans have more men and more weapons, but if we fight the African way, we can wear them down. We will hit and run, ensnare them in traps, ambush them, and take refuge in the swamps and the hammocks. We will engage them in battle until they can take no more. When they realize that they cannot win against us, then we will demand to stay in Florida or have free passage with the Seminoles out west. Yes, Micanopy, place your X on this spot. Let us smoke the pipe to signal the peace. But there will be no peace until Africans are free.
In general, organization and leadership within communities is paramount. How did these new communities organize themselves? Did they appoint leaders who could increase their chances of survival?
I think it's important to look at various types of models for how these communities came together, and at Pilikokaha, or Abraham's town, that I examined, I talk about it in terms of different social processes. One would be the process of, you know, escape and flight from the Carolinas and from Georgia. Another part will be the process of coming into Florida and establishing oneself as, you know, a newly liberated African or African American amongst a group of Native Americans who you're not fully sure what they're going to do with you, right, in terms of if they'll turn you in or try to enslave you themselves. So there had to be a process of negotiation that took place, and people had to, you know, be very diplomatic and have a lot of social savvy. Another part of the process would be traveling across Florida, and the folks who would inhabit Abraham's town, they traveled all the way from Georgia, so they had to, you know, cross different Native American territories. They had to cross different colonial territories, so it was quite a precarious thing to travel all that way and to have to potentially translate your intentions and motivations to various people you encounter along the way and hope that they don't betray you or enslave you or try to capture you or whatever. Well, that was another thing that one had to consider when establishing this community, the logistics of it. One had to go and build houses, you know, you had to chop trees down. One had to potentially think about, you know, are you going to be safe here? Do you build walls, or do you just kind of rely on word of mouth if someone was coming down the, you know, down the river, you know, after you? So people had to think about all these things when they were building communities, not just the social relations, not just the diplomacy thing, but just the real world logistics of just having to build from the ground up, literally. And what we try to get at archaeologically are things, you know, from the opposite perspective. You know, they kind of took things that were part of their environment, stuck them into the ground, and then we try to recover the things that have been left behind. Like, who were the organizers? You know, as I said before, charismatic individuals, and I think Abraham of Abraham's town was one of them, are a part of the story, an important part. Some of them were skilled at warfare and fighting, and that made a lot of sense, you know, for a community of people who really relied on the skills and the leadership of people who could strategize and keep them safe. Other leaders might have relied more on diplomacy. I get a sense that Abraham might have been more like that. However, I think in the big picture, you know, having a variety of skills would have serve most leaders the best in terms of having fighting skills, being good diplomats, speaking a variety of languages, because you have to negotiate with neighboring Native Americans and potentially people who were crossing the territory, trading goods, right? You know, to make sure one could arrange certain sorts of economic situations so that you could supply yourself, because people didn't just go into the wilderness and live apart, you know, from the rest of the world. You know, in some cases they did, but in cases like Abraham's town, they didn't. And I think that was to their advantage.
What role did African Seminoles play within the Alliance? How significant was their contribution?
When we talk about the African Seminoles, often folks project them as being vassals. They say vassals to the Native Americans. But you see, what actually these folks had independent, at times, independent bodies, independent operations. But they understand they had alliances with each other. So yes, they will minimize the true role of these Africans with the gods and saying, oh no, they're just an interpreter. They're just a vassal for Chief Wildcat, that this person is just a vassal for them, just an interpreter. So again, they minimize the role so that in that way, no one else is going to think that these Africans are on par to being autonomous rulers and leaders. Where now you have Native American Seminoles who are also now playing both sides of the fence. When it's to their advantage, they take advantage of getting rid of some family members for some other African Seminoles. Where they make, because it was about money. Let's just go, just for real, it's about money, about control. And so they played that game, and that's a sad part to the story.
We should bear in mind that slaves were deemed a commodity, and therefore slaveholders were not apt to easily relinquish their valuable property. Maroons, as well as African Seminoles, lived with the all-too-real possibility of being betrayed, recaptured, and forced back into slavery. So did they fight to maintain their freedom? Ultimately, what became of Maroons and African Seminoles in Florida?
Many times people talk about the Seminole Wars, but some scholars are now realizing and say that, you know, we can't go and say that this is the Seminole Wars, but this is actually a Gullah War. This is tied to the Africans who have now escaped out of what we know the Gullah Geechee Quarter, the Gullah Geechee Nation. They have now made a way into Florida, and they are now forming relationships with Native Americans. And Native Americans and those Africans are now dealing with another enemy, and that enemy is the United States government. The United States government is now trying to basically take Africans and bring them back to their property owners, and then also now trying to take over the lands that we know as Florida today, and that they're identifying with the Native Americans. But you would have one general, Thomas C. Jessup. He would write to them in Washington and say, listen, this is not an Indian war we're fighting. He said, this is a Negro war. So again, the wars they call Seminole Wars, a lot of times are based as some of them realize, they say, this is being prompted by and pushed by these Africans. And what's going on? To the same point about when we said about Maroons. Independence, autonomy, wanting to make sure that they still had control over their families and their destiny. So that's what happened. That's why these Africans are so willing to continue to fight. You have the relationship with Osceola and Africans. You have African Seminoles serving as interpreters for Native American Seminole leaders. So again, all this is going on because they have that same desire. And I have to go and say this. That goes back to the 1600s. That's what King Carlos realized also when he now had Africans coming out of Georgia and South Carolina going to Florida. He said that all you have to do to come down here to Fort Moses is that you have to become Catholic and pick up arms to defend the Spanish crown. Because he realized that these people right here are going to basically fight because it's about their families. So the Maroons that we see in the 1800s that are now in Florida, again, the African Seminoles, are fighting for their families. But now we're going to look at the other smaller Maroons that people tend not to identify with, those same people who are now escaping and going into swamps, going into mountains, going into other plains that have basically not been touched by Europeans or Caucasians. That's the same thing they're trying to do. They're still trying to maintain. If they're on islands here that have not been touched yet by Europeans or Caucasians, these folks are not dealing with trying to maintain their societies with their families, but that external force now, that one day someone may come in and realize that they're there, and they now have to defend, they have to flee. So classic example of fight or flight. And that those folks also must be recognized as saying have the Maroon origins too, because it's all about independence and autonomy, and also maintaining that family together. But later on, you have something that's occurring in northern Florida at Fort Negro. Fort Negro, Fort of Africans. Also with Native Americans there too. And they're now dealing with the federal government, that is the U.S. Army. And so this is also an outpost and also a sanctuary, again, for runaways too. And so the government is not coming in, and they're not pursuing these folks, and there's a battle that will ensue. And there is an explosion that will later occur from, say, from a cannonball that now hits a munition area there, and now you have the explosion, and you have the loss of life and also injuries to the Native Americans who are there and also the Africans. So Fort Negro also becomes one of those pinnacle points for Southerners now to go and say, wait a minute, there's an issue going on here, and this cannot come out to the larger American population. Because if it comes out to the larger population, the media now will get a hold of this. And as I share, folks, what happens, in particular with Fort Negro, and again, the Gullah Wars, that this is now involving national security. That this is one of the first moments that we see national security come into play, where the federal government is now saying, we can't put this out, because now this is a danger. This is a danger to Southern lifestyles, because Africans in Georgia, South Carolina, Alabama, they're not gonna rise up, because when they hear about these Africans and the incidents at Fort Negro, if that's played out and thrown out there to the populace and thrown out to the world. So this is, again, when we look at places such as Angola, that's in Florida, and the other works that's going on with regards to the African Seminoles, again, fighting, and also those Gullah Geechee people now leaving out of South Carolina and Georgia, and later on, folks leaving out of Alabama and Southern Georgia, going down to Florida and joining, because they're here. That's a sanctuary for us. Because that's what happened, and people don't realize it, that Florida became a sanctuary, it became a beacon of light and hope for autonomy for Africans. No one wanted to be in captivity. So that's why I tell them, when you talk about Maroons, you must look at the larger story. People understand that no one wanted to be held in captivity, and they had to find pockets of freedom. And that's what happened when we look at Florida, and that's why, again, Fort Negro became that sanctuary for many of them.
In some cases, we find Islam and other so-called old world, you know, religions and, you know, cultural systems popping up in association with Maroons. And one of the reasons why I'd like to discuss Islam is that, one, there's a relevance to slavery and anti-slavery resistance. Let's just start with Africa, and, you know, in cases we have Muslims enslaving Africans. Some Africans were Muslims enslaving other Africans, but we also have a precedent for, you know, various forms of like manumission, right? There's a part of the religious system that accounts for the possibility of manumission. So there's an ideological, you know, justification and precedent for people finding avenues to freedom, you know.
These forts help to demarcate an area that the U.S. government and military established in order to contain people. And that was an important part of the strategy, is kind of containing people and then squeezing them, you know, until eventually you can circumscribe them and control them. And so this was a gradual process whereby these forts were built, but a lot of them emerged after a conflict that emerged right up here where you see the word Dade, and that's the infamous, in the eyes of the U.S. military, battleground, you know, the Dade Massacre battleground, as some people term it, where we still have reenactments, you know, going on. Things came to a head at what is today termed the Dade Battleground, you know, or the place of the Dade Massacre, where U.S. troops, led by an officer by the name of Dade, traveled in 1835 and met up with an ambush, basically, and many of them were annihilated because they were, you know, taken by surprise. And according to the histories, there's only like one or two survivors who would live to tell the story, right? So this was one of the low points for the U.S. military, but there were years of fighting and frustration for many U.S. officers, and you can look at the changing of the guard, which happened frequently as the U.S. government tried to find different military leaders who could finish off the Seminole forces, but it wasn't an easy job. And African Seminoles left as a part of the Trail of Tears, right? We often don't think of the Trail of Tears as an African-American or African phenomenon, but there were Africans who traveled on the Trail of Tears, whether we talk about the Seminole of Florida, or as I'm currently doing right now, I'm looking at a group of Native Americans called Chickasaw and their relationship with enslaved Africans, and Africans were a part of their migration to places like Oklahoma. So as a part of that whole process, as the wars started to fizzle out, and under flags of truce, you know, Seminoles and Africans eventually were captured, and the paper trail that emerged, which I often think of as kind of like a prisoner of war list, but they termed it emigration lists, right, where emigrating people were there, and they're moving from here out west. And even under challenging circumstances, we find family groupings, like at Abraham's Town, I found about 16 family groupings, and we find fathers and mothers and groups of children, you know, within these families. So it's an important part of the conversation we need to have about, you know, the organization of society. You know, it emerged from a very logical place, you know, kinship ties. So that's a part of how the Seminole Wars, or the Gullah Wars, you know, helps to tell, you know, the story of the African Seminoles.
Maroons in the Caribbean and Latin America led successful uprisings, and the prowess of their legendary warriors has been well documented. In the U.S., many distinguished heroes can be counted among the Maroons and African Seminoles. These freedom fighters demonstrated exemplary valor in the struggle for freedom. Just who were they?
Probably the greatest enemy of the U.S. military was John Horse, also known as Gopher John. John Horse was just a fighter. He was a military man, and he was involved in, of course, the Second Seminole War. He also was very involved once they got to Texas. He took the group. They knew that they would have no peace in the United States, so he took that group of Maroons, and he established a town in Mexico, Nacimiento, Mexico. And so John Horse is very well known as being a real fighter, African Seminole fighter, and the one who helped lead his people over into Mexico and establish a community there.
Some indigenous women married into these communities. In the case of Abraham's Town, we have a Seminole, indigenous Seminole leader by the name of Micanopy, who had two wives, and they lived in Abraham's Town. So he would come and visit, and I think the chroniclers refer to them as half-breeds, you know, the kind of derogatory as we recognize it today. But, you know, that might be an indication of this kind of bicultural or biracial or multicultural, you know, heritage that folks had. But it also is an indicator of how membership in communities wasn't limited, you know, to people of African descent. You know, involved a variety of different people. In some cases, we might have had Europeans traveling through the region, either on reconnaissance, or people who might have been, you know, marketing wares, or maybe even pirates who were traveling through the region, who would anchor off the coast of, you know, Florida and exchange goods. Some of them would visit these villages and take up temporary residence, doing whatever they were going to do. So we have to understand the diversity of the communities in that sense as well, you know, that this would change the social relationships and the composition of these communities.
As you brought about Abraham, that he's viewed as saying, being a translator, interpreter. So, and that's what they constantly throw out about Abraham. And so I'm going to say, hey, one of the classic examples, bow legs. So again, you have those figures that are right there who are also military leaders. That's the aspect that I look at. I'm like, these are military leaders. These are part of the genius that we talk about when they're now being successful with regards to waging war against the federal government. Or I should say, defending against the federal government. I shouldn't say they were waging a war, because they were trying to live peacefully and to maintain their families and their maroonage. So, and but also I go on to say, there's another generation that comes up later on that we know as the Seminole Indian Scouts, descendants of these folks, like Pompey Factor. Again, people who dedicated their lives now saying, hey, our families have basically been somewhat persecuted by the federal government, by the U.S. Army, but now we now play a role to go out to serving them, and serving them with valor.
The courage and indomitable spirit of the Maroons and African Seminoles lives on through stories passed down from generation to generation. Untold numbers of descendants have dedicated their lives to preserving this precious history for posterity.
My great-great-grandfather, Alan Watkins, was enslaved with his sister on a plantation near Radford, Virginia. Now, I have not found out if the kids were there by themselves or if Uncle Luther didn't mention their parents. But anyway, his sister, a young 9-year-old, stuck her finger in some molasses, and the mistress saw her, and she was whipped so badly that she died of her injuries. My great-great-grandfather, Alan, was so enraged that he set the plantation house on fire, and he escaped across what my family called the Radford River, which was really the New River. And he went, I guess, and lived in caves and whatever, and actually became a Maroon. And it was not until years later, I guess after the war, I know that part of West Virginia was free, and he, from my understanding, he probably, after he went through his Maroonage, that stage, he may have come across some other people and found out that he could be free. I'm not sure. Now, on my mother's side, another interesting story, my great uncle, Thompson Long, my great grandfather, Austin Long, was the son of one of the Longs, plantation owner or his sons. My great-grandmother, Martha Baker, was his mother. The Longs did have a code among them that they would not sell any of their slaves who had Long blood, white blood. And so they were going to sell Thompson Long. Thompson Long, and I'm sure with the help of his mother and other slaves in the plantation, escaped. And this was in Florida, and he lived as a Maroon in Florida until after the Civil War.
My name is John Griffin. I'm a black Seminole descendant, and in modern times, I'm the vice mayor of my city, Groveland, Florida, Lake County. My great-great-granddaddy was a black man who lived in Lower Peachtree, Alabama. He decided that he wanted to come down into Florida, and he dressed up as though he was a woman, and his wife and kids as though two sisters was traveling. He came down from Lower Peachtree, Alabama to Hernando County near a town called Brooksville. He came down and lived with the Indians, the Seminole Indians, and we couldn't figure out why would he leave Alabama and come down and live with the Indians. We found out that he knew the Indians in Alabama, and he had heard that the Red Sticks in Alabama, a faction of them had moved to Brooksville, Florida. He came down and lived with them, and then after a period of time, his son grew up and married a Seminole woman and moved her to his farm. So that's my great-great-grandmother. Her name was Sally. The black Seminoles that lived near the Seminole people, they dressed like the Seminoles. They took up the practices of the Seminoles. Not all blacks live near the Seminoles, but what I'm wearing today, I'm portraying that I'm a black Seminole chief. The feathers I'm wearing in the back of my turban denotes that I'm a chief. If my feathers was in the front, it would denote that I am a medicine man. But if my feather was on the left-hand side, that means I'm a single man. If my feather was running to the back on the right-hand side, meaning I'm a married man. But I'm a chief. I'm a Miko. And basically, I'm wearing the shirt is called a long shirt. It's a long piece of material, come down almost to the knee. And I'm wearing leggings to protect my legs from briars, palmettos, anything that can cut in the flesh. And I'm wearing alligator teeth. We adorn ourselves with different things out of nature, as well as things we traded with white people for. So Seminoles, actually, I've heard it called the peacocks of the southern pines.
Where do modern-day descendants live? Like their ancestors, they believe in self-determination and are proud of their unique heritage. How do descendants see and refer to themselves?
And today, you know, the modern Seminole tribe of Florida, this is largely where they live, and we find large territories and reservation areas down here. And some of the fallout of the destruction of the Sarasota community, so-called Angola community, right? That's part of the Looking for Angola project that's going on now. Some of those folks relocated to Central Florida, and you see a settlement by the name of Minati, and that's much closer to the seat of power and, you know, the safety zone that would have been created, you know, by the presence of a large African and Seminole population living here in Central Florida.
Today, descendants refer to themselves in various ways. In when we go to the Bahamas, or when we go to places like Texas and Oklahoma or Mexico, we'll get different answers to that question. You know, who are you? You know, some will refer to themselves as Black Seminoles, others as freedmen and or scouts, you know, depending on who you talk to. Some Black Seminoles, and it also varies in terms of the time we're talking about. If you were to ask a descendant that question, you know, who are you, you know, and they would have probably given you different answers based on when you asked them, and people who are ethnographers, scholars, and historians have talked about this. So, you know, if we're talking 20 years ago or 30 or 40 years ago, they might have referred to themselves as scouts or freedmen. Some descendants I've talked to describe how some of their ancestors would simply refer to themselves as Indians, you know. So I think there's a lot of complexity to this and a lot of diversity, and sometimes we want simple answers, you know, to that question.
What was the moral fabric of African Seminole Maroon society? How are these values being upheld and disseminated among today's youth?
One of the things that we've done at the Blanchard House is to create materials that we think can be used for social action. We're especially interested in working with young people. We started a program, the New Image Project, that uses historical narrative, the narrative of the Seminole, African Seminole Maroons, to not only teach young people untold and untaught history, but also to help them learn how to develop those attributes, those very positive attributes of the Maroons, like self-definition. I am not a slave. I am a free person. I should not be enslaved. I deserve to be free. Self-determination, I will not be enslaved. Or self-direction, I will find a way out of this. So these attributes we use in our materials, in our program, to teach young people not only the history, but also how they can apply these same attributes of the Maroons in their own lives.
What is the historical significance of the Maroon and African Seminole experience? What can it teach us, and how can we learn more? Conserving this cultural heritage is more critical than ever.
We really admire and adore people who are freedom fighters. Let us admire our heroes in this country, our first freedom fighters. Before the American Revolution, there were freedom fighters. Before Paul Revere said, "Give me liberty or give me death," Africans said, "I will die before I will be enslaved again." Let us recognize our true freedom fighters and our first freedom fighters in this country who were Maroons. And secondly, let us look honestly at who they were and the kinds of communities that they were able to establish. And let us use that as a model for creating safe communities where people come together and connect, and the entire community benefits.
It's important that we think about archaeological sites not just in terms of, you know, what we've learned from them, but, you know, just thinking ahead to, you know, the resources that are available to descendant communities, to, you know, future generations in our society. They're important places that have a lot to offer, and as our techniques of doing research improve over the years, it's likely that we're going to learn a lot of things that those of us who study now, you know, we're going to look at some incredible findings as the technologies change for recovering data, and as a critical mass of people come and start doing this archaeology, we're likely to learn a lot more. So I think that it's important that we preserve and protect these sites. We can't take for granted that they're going to exist, just like we can't take for granted that elders are going to exist and continue to tell these stories, right?
My main goal is to get out to the world, especially the black people of America, to stress the point that we were stressing towards that mark to be free. We wanted to be free, and we paid a toll for it. And when we came in contact with the Native American people, they were having their quest for freedom also, and we combined our efforts to be free, hoping that our generation will recognize that black people always work towards freedom and taking care of their families.
How can young people and young adults get information, or adults in general get information? One source, I'll say, you got the internet. We can use the internet to gain some information, to find those leads with regards to that. But we do have the books that are out there also. And we have the cultural centers that are also there, just like Gitchikunda in Riceboro, Georgia. That is repository for African culture and history here in the U.S. and beyond, where we're able to share information with regards to that. And books by Sylvan and Jolf, excellent books that I've seen from her. And there are some books on Jamaican Maroonage that I've seen also. So I can tell folks, if they contact us, we can provide you with some of the information. We give a book list with regards to a lot of information showing the connections. I think folks who want to look at Brazil, you got to look at the story of Maurício Maim and the Mali and the revolutions that occurred there. Here, if we look at the U.S., look at the stories with regards to what occurred in the Great Dismal Swamp, the stories that are tied to Stono, because Stono is also part of an inspiration for freedom. And we look at Fort Moses going down to St. Augustine, Florida. Going to St. Augustine also, at times, they may not tell you the fullness of the story, but they have sources down there also that can provide you with that information. The African Seminoles, the story now, the state of Florida, is now going into some aspects with regard to the story. Also, I'd say, go out to Oklahoma. Also, a place that we can go to National Archives. National Archives has some of the sources also with regard to the time period that we're looking at, and then coming up today. And also looking at the Dawes roles and seeing who were some of the people there and what were some of the roles that they played. There's a book by Joshua Giddings that gives you some sense of what it was like in the 1800s. He was an Ohio congressman in the 1800s, and he was one of the few people that spoke about the African Seminoles when it was involving that same national security issue. So I would say his book is one of the books to definitely look at. I'm going to say, when I look at African Seminoles, and going to say, we got to know about their story, what happened. So now why I say, when we're talking about Maroons, people saying, oh no, they can't. I'm like, no, there's a commonality to this right here in the U.S. But then we not look outside the U.S. and then you start realizing like, oh, in Brazil they had, oh my God. In the Caribbean they had, oh, in Central America. And guess what? We all start saying our ancestors all had that desire for freedom. As I said, that unquenchable thirst and desire for freedom. And that, guess what? That brings us together. And we start realizing, hey, we are one. You know, we're not so separate as people try to make it seem like, no, we all have that same desire, even though you might speak Spanish, you might speak Portuguese, you might speak Dutch, you might speak English. Guess what? We're all one. And then we begin to see how we all, as I say, children of the sun.
You can explore the very places where Maroons lived, meet some of their descendants, and experience their enduring rich culture and traditions. Who are the Gullah Geechee people?
The Gullah Geechees initially were people from West Africa primarily. So you had everywhere from the Senegambia down to Angola. And you had the Igbo, Mandinka, Malinke, Yoruba, Gola, Gizi, Mendi, Temni, Fik, Ibibio, and various other West African groups that were kidnapped, transported across the Middle Passage, and then were placed on these sea islands during chattel enslavement. They then started to interact with and some intermarried the Kusabo, the Yemisi, the Edisto, the Cree, who were the indigenous American people that resided on these islands before chattel enslavement or the transatlantic slave trade. So as Gullah Geechees, we then have in our DNA both Africa and America. The thing is there's been a long journey of connection and reconnection through our language. That the language is Gullah, the people are Gullah, the dialect of the Gullah language is Geechee, and the people are Geechee, all right? But people often wonder, where did you get these words Gullah and Geechee? The term Gullah means people blessed by God. And it originally came from Angolans. Those were some of the first Africans directly kidnapped from the motherland of Al-Kabulan and brought over to Carolina, in particular in through Sullivan's Island, which is in Charleston County, north of here. And that was where over 40% of all Africans enslaved in North America came through, Sullivan's Island. And then they, after being isolated in pest houses or pestilence houses for days to weeks, for seasoning, to break you down for sale, to get you fit for sale on an auction block in downtown Charlestown, which is Charleston, South Carolina, which became the number one enslavement auction block in North America. And the second was Wall Street in the East River in New York City, okay? When they did this, many people today don't recognize that that was the mechanism by which the Africans were brought in. But the Angolans were brought in that way. And because the Angolans would usually be found in uprisings, eventually there became a ban on the importation, more or less an embargo against bringing in Angolans. So they started to kidnap people from the Windward Coast, Rice Coast, where our Carolina Gold rice comes from, that many people read about, that Gullah Geechees worked in Carolina Gold rice, indigo, and Sea Island cotton. Well, they brought in those who had the knowledge of this. There was scientific engineering that goes behind creating rice dikes and trunks on sea islands in the Atlantic Ocean, in salt water, needing fresh water to grow tons of rice to feed not only the people here, but around the world this rice went. Around the world, sea island cotton went. Around the world went the indigo blocks once they were created to dye the fancy clothes even over in Europe, darling. I think has been critical to our survival is the foundation of faith, the foundation of family, and that's what is our community. And for us, the land is family, and the waterways are our bloodline.
I am a descendant of the Mosquito Fleet. We are people who were the fishermen that fed Charleston for 150 years before and after the Civil War, up until 1953, when the state of South Carolina started codifying and regulating the seafood industry. Up until, I guess, really the early 70s, my brothers continued to shrimp, and at one point my family had 6 shrimp trawlers. We only have 1 left now. And we shrimp from basically the coast of South Carolina, around the east and west side of Florida, as well as the Gulf Coast, as well as Texas. Members of the Mosquito Fleet were in fact Gullah people. They were the Africans who were able to utilize their skills that brought over here with them. We were also people who manned the Mosquito Fleet or participated because we're from the islands. That is John's Island, James Island, Waimalua, right around the Charleston area. And we, the uniqueness about the Mosquito Fleet is that they would leave Charleston on a daily basis when weather permitted, with the falling tide, go as far as 30 miles offshore, came back with fresh seafood.
What is the Great Dismal Swamp like today?
Greetings, my name is Dolores Freeman. I'm the Visitor Services Specialist for the Great Dismal Swamp National Wildlife Refuge in southeastern Virginia, northeastern North Carolina. Today I'd like to tell you a little bit about our refuge. The refuge was established in 1974 by an act of Congress, because we are part of the Department of Interior. One of our first visitors, colonial visitors, was a young man who was a professional farmer, and he was traveling through the area, and he wandered into the Great Dismal Swamp, and he thought it was a glorious paradise. And he saw it as an opportunity for valuable resources for the local growing communities. That young man's name was George Washington, and him and some investors before the Revolutionary War received the title for 50,000 acres of the Great Dismal Swamp. Mr. Washington's land company decided to drain part of the swamp, and what they were trying to do was establish plantations in an agricultural business. They tried rice plantations, they tried a silk crop, they tried several different things, but they were not successful in that. But what they did find was a lot of valuable timber. And the timber was something that the local communities needed for the shipbuilding trades and for the housing that was in the area. So the harvesting of this land began then in the mid-1700s. It continued until 1974, when the refuge was established. We have 22 different species of snakes that sometimes frighten our visitors. We have over 200 species of neotropical birds that come through here in the spring and the fall. And we have a variety of extra popular residents, such as the bald eagle, Swainson's warblers. We have almost 100 different species of butterflies that people come to see when they come visit us. So there's something here for just about everyone.
The story of the American Maroons is as riveting as it is moving and inspiring, and deserves to be told. While in some regions of the country many are familiar with this pivotal chapter of American history, countless others are unaware. It belongs to U.S. history textbooks as part of the national narrative. Creation and mobilization of educational resources can help bridge the gap. Starting at the grassroots level, everyone can do their part to preserve and promote Maroon history and culture. Maroons were freedom fighters. Their fortitude and tenacity helped them break the shackles of slavery, even if for some, only temporarily, and carve out a bigger destiny for themselves and future generations, a lesson for us all.